All right, guys, we have the Tennessee Titans going to the Redskins. Honestly, I could care less. Freaking Titans. I mean, they probably got a good defense offensively, but we'll just go through them. Obviously, they still have Derrick Henry. I don't know why they didn't take, but here we go, guys. Titans 2023 Rest Grades. And with that, what is going on, guys? Welcome back to Final Now, of course. Please like and subscribe. I hope you guys enjoy the Tennessee Titans 2023 roster grades. I'll fix that. Back to it, though, of course. This Titans team is a little weird. We'll get right into it, of course, right after this. And again, we'll just go through it really quick. I go through all the roster grade again, we'll go through the every single offensive position, talk about the overall roster grade. I want to say average out to, but about it, like, means to, kind of like that. Defensively, same type of thing. And then, again, go through that. Individually, special teams, and we'll talk about the whole team and the whole overall depth of it. The team identity, which is basically how each side of the ball, how I think they're going to play this year, and whether it's sustainable or not, basically. Because the style of play you play is huge. If you don't do it the right way, I mean, you're going to end up like the Broncos every year, at least last year, yeah. And then, after all that, again, some positions like depth and identity, they're the reason we're doing last, because they're basically the most important parts. And again, defense and offense are going to be probably, again, most points. And then we add that with special teams, and we get basically a total amount of points, which comes out to a letter grade. That's what I got there, guys. Let's get right into it with the quarterback position. Here is Ryan Tannehill. Oh, yeah, I want to quickly say something. Melvin Gordon said that the running back shouldn't be paid. We're kind of screwed. No crap, you're part of it, moron. I mean, my bad. But, yeah, Melvin Gordon, you're really one of the reasons that these guys don't get paid. If you didn't sit out and you, like, played well, they would have paid you money. But back to it. With the Titans, of course, the quarterback position. First off, Will Levis. I actually like Will Levis. I mean, super raw. Many people think he's actually not as talented as they say. He is. He's a talented very raw, talented quarterback. He has the best arm in the draft class. I wouldn't say generational arm, but pretty darn close. He does show flashes of making throws, though. Again, very sloppy. Footwork needs a lot of work. He's not the most talented up in the head, but he can still process well, and he also is very good at instincts and anticipation, and also can run. He's actually very sneaky athletic, so Will Levis is a very underrated quarterback, in my opinion, but has a lot to work to do before he gets in the field, because if he does, he'll end up like Malik Willis did last year, and pretty much from the get-go, preseason, training camp, he was awful. I mean, he was not ready to go, I'll just put it like that. 2-3 interceptions, yes, but he actually, the one game I think he actually played somewhat not, oh God, was against the Chiefs. And he still was pretty awful, 5 of 16, but at least he didn't sell. I think he might have had one fumble, but he wasn't awful. He didn't complete any passes, but he wasn't as bad as you'd think he would be, even though he was really bad. Malik Willis, terrible rookie season, shouldn't have been on the field. Like, I hope you warned that. And he also didn't run the ball well either for a guy who's supposed to be a monster on the ground. Like, wasn't terrible, but he definitely should have gotten more opportunities there. I mean, Titans offensive coordinator Todd Downing, thank God he's gone. Who the heck's their new dude? I literally forgot their offensive coordinator. Oh, it's Tim Kelly. Not gonna lie, I forgot Tim Kelly was on the Titans coaching staff. I'm not even kidding. Not offensive coordinator. I knew he was, but I just forgot he was on their. So he's kind of irrelevant, but I do think he'll be able to use Malik Willis better. If he plays, I don't think he will, though. Will Levis will definitely go over him. And back to it, Ryan Tannehill. He started 14 games, I think. 12, yeah. He wasn't healthy last year. I mean, he was okay, I guess. Like, he actually was a lot more conservative, which I think was good. But then again, he didn't throw the ball too much. He actually had some big-time games. Yeah, I mean, he had that one game against the Packers where he was really good. But overall, I actually don't think Ryan Tannehill had that bad of a year. I do think he definitely got outplayed by some quarterbacks. But then again, they all have better receiving corps. So, yeah. Ryan Tannehill, I think, is a decent quarterback, which might surprise some people. But he's won some big games. Again, yeah, you can say he's regressing. He can still run the football well. I really don't see a problem with Ryan Tannehill. Like, you got to realize he's a good quarterback. Like, is he elite? No, but I think he's good. And with Ryan Tannehill in the quarterback room, I'm going to C+, because, yeah, they got a lot of raw guys as backup, which is not good. But at least they have guys that are notable as backups. There's other teams that don't. And I think Ryan Tannehill is a good quarterback. Like, C+. I think he's good. C+. Like, he's a little above average. He's not average. He's a little above it. Because he wasn't average last year. Was he great? No. But he did show some places where he was really good. So, yeah, Ryan Tannehill really hasn't been legit since 2020. And, yeah. But in 2021, even, he played well in some big games. I mean, he definitely wasn't the reason they won a lot of those games. But he did help them win games. I'll be honest. That's what's like there. Comes out to 15, 30 points for that quarterback room. Time for the running back position. I mean, it's kind of easy, peasy, lemon squeezy. Like, I don't know what to say. it's Derrick Henry. Like, he's the only back left in the NFL. Outside of, you could say Josh Jacobs, but probably not even him. Who is simply, you could give him like 190 carries in a row, like every single down you play for a couple weeks, he'd be fine. I legitimately think Derrick Henry is the last workhorse back in the league. Yeah, Bijan Robinson, but they're not going to give him as many carries as Derrick Henry got. Pretty simple. Derrick Henry, again, in my opinion, is the last workhorse back in the league. He is the best back in the league, too. He's just, you can't tackle him. You might say, oh, he might not break as many tackles as you'd think he would. He still breaks a ton of tackles. Very good vision for a dude who didn't have it in the past. He's turned himself and he's the best back in the league. Tajay Spears, actually another bowling ball back as well. Can't give him as many carries, though, because he does have a tendency to wear down as the game goes on, which isn't great. And he's also, for a guy who's kind of smaller, he actually does run like a bowling ball. He's a really tough runner. I like him a lot. Hassan Haskins still has that great speed. I mean, he's a really good back. Yeah, didn't have a great rookie year, but I do still have hope for him. Wasn't great as a rookie, but I do have some, again, hope for him. Jonathan Ward, pretty good gadget, trusted teamer type of dude. It's kind of about it, though. I mean, they got three decent backs. It's a pretty good backfield. A+, I mean, it's him and, when you get the Niners, you'll see, too. So, didn't we do the Niners? I forgot. Whatever, A+. That comes out, too. 15, 30, 45, 60. I think we did do the Niners. I gave him, like, probably an A+, probably for the running back position, I hope. So, yeah, A+. Time for the wide receiver core. And if I'm being brutally honest, if they did not have D-Hop, I would think this is by far the worst receiving core in the league. D-Hop last year when he played was really freaking good. He would have definitely hit 1,000 yards if he played more than 9 games. He would have hit, like, 1,500 probably. And, yeah, only 3 touchdowns, but he had freaking Trace McSorley. Who else? Colt McCoy for a good amount of time. And, David Blau throwing, no, David Blau didn't throw the football. He just wouldn't allow that. But even Kyler, Kyler didn't ever, like, I mean, he was decent, I guess, but he wasn't great. So, yeah, like, D-Hop is legit. He's a top 10 receiver. But he definitely doesn't mask everything else. Treylon Burks, I mean, promising rookie season, I guess, but I still expect him, a better year at least. He's going to be their best default player downfield. Yes, DeAndre Hopkins is still going to get a lot of targets downfield, in my opinion, but he still needs to be the possession receiver. I honestly think this receiving core is just so much more deep with him. Kyle Phillips wasn't healthy last year. I think he played like four games. Kyle Phillips I like a lot. He's a very speedy receiver, but he is small, and he definitely struggles to make contested catches if he can't get separation. Struggles in the press, but very speedy, very smooth type of slot receiver. I think he's really good. Nick Westbrook, I don't even know what to say. Like, how the heck is he on this team? I mean, yes, he can make some big catches once in a while. Yes, he's a little flashy, but he's not good. Like, I don't even know what to say. He got, like, there's a reason Kyle Phillips is ahead of him. He's just not that good. Chris Moore, big play merchant. That's kind of about it. Honestly, wasn't too bad last year. Wait, didn't he play with the Bears or something? No, he was in the Texans. What am I saying? I mean, yeah, he's a big play merchant. I mean, he can make some plays actually decent at separating, but not consistent enough really at all to, like, really warrant anything else, but he's pretty decent. Richard McNabb is a bum, and the rest of these dudes are kind of also bums. So, maybe Reggie Robertson Jr. could be decent. FSMU is an interesting player, but, I mean, they got 3 good receivers, and the rest of these guys are bums. I mean, Chris Moore actually could be decent, but this receiving core is a lot better than I expected it to be. In this tight end receiving core, I'll actually give a C+, because I think Kyle Phillips should be very good this year if he can stay healthy. The depth actually isn't as bad as you think. Even as bad as Nick Westbrook is, just because he's not a starter doesn't mean he can be a decent, like, backup receiver. But they got some experience. They got 6 receivers, I guess. More like 3, but it's definitely a not. You know, I give it a C? I'll give it a C, because Treylon Burks is just not a number 2 yet. And I like Kyle Phillips a lot in the slot, but he does not offer you anything else. And again, yeah, D-Hop's really good, but I don't know. I can't give him a C, because they only have 3 really starting caliber receivers. The rest of these dudes, are just not very good. So I gotta give him a C. That's what I got. 9, 15 points. Time for the tight end position. I mean, Chizikonkwo is really good. Because you might think, yeah, his numbers aren't crazy last year. But not only is he one of the only tight ends in the league that I think is consistently put him 30 yards downfield, he will make a big play. He's one of the only tight ends in the league to do that. He's a bowling ball in the open field, like yak type of tight end. And he has the talent and the athleticism to be a really good run blocker. Is he a really good run blocker yet? No. But he definitely showed some really good signs towards the end of the season that he could be that. Chizikonkwo is very close to being a top 10 tight end if he could just put it all together this season. He is very good. Trayvon Wesco, weird type of tight end because he's been a backup his whole career. He isn't great, but honestly, you could have a worse backup. He's not good, but he works. Josh Weil, and honestly, Mac, I've heard of Josh Weil, but I'm going to be honest, I saw him, like, play two games in Cincinnati, pretty irrelevant, was a backup for a little while. He's, like, whatever. Elias Mack, can you pronounce his name? I have no idea what the frick that guy is. But they've got pretty much two tight ends, so that's kind of what I got. If Chiz gets hurt, it's probably going to be a little bit of an issue. And again, it was just his rookie season. Chizikonkwo had a really solid rookie season, but then again, he basically just played at a good level. Like, he wasn't elite, even though he had a lot of good flashes. I'll give this tight end core on Burma B-minus because Trayvon Wesco is a decent like third tight end, but he's definitely not a good, like, again, if Chiz gets hurt, it's not going to be great. And again, all potential, they could have maybe an A-minus, but again, they just don't have a number two tight end, so I got to give him a B-minus. And Chiz is probably, outside of DeAndre Hopkins, is probably the best receiving option on this team, at least right now. So, number one's getting reliable because I do think Treylon Burks could absolutely torch any defense, but he doesn't have the great speed, but he's just a really good deep route runner. I just don't think, like, again, he's just not reliable or consistent enough. That comes out to 14 points. Time for this offensive line. Oh, baby. All right. The only good thing about this offensive line is that there's some depth. That's what I got. Jalen Duncan is actually a solid backup tackle. He still needs to work on his run blocking. I don't really know why they drafted him. I mean, he's good at a shotgun, I guess, but he's definitely more of a pass blocker. He needs a lot of work to really become a good enough power run blocker for this team. Also, Jordan Roos, basically a third stringer. Don't know what he's doing. Corey Levin actually is not that bad of a backup. He's been a pretty solid vet his whole career. Andrew Rupich, not going to lie, I've never heard of him. Chris Hubbard, former Brown. He's been in the league a while. Decent vet, but you don't want him starting. That's all I got to say. So they actually have two decent backups. Dylan Radunz, again, wasn't he a second-round pick? Yeah, he was a second-round pick in 2021. He's been horrible. There's a reason he's here. Was he on the PUP list? Yeah, he won't be around for a while, but he would be starting if he was on this team. you know, I said, you don't want Chris Hubbard starting? Good chance Jalen Duncan will get the start at right tackle with their best offensive line, in my opinion. Nicholas Petitfrere bringing out six games. I mean, as a rookie, he wasn't great, but he's actually a lot more talented people give him credit for. He's a little bit of a goofball, but he's a really good run blocker, and I definitely think he could be a lot better. Again, his pass blocking was absolutely horrible last year, but honestly, it's just overall, like, technique, but he still prevented, like, four or five sacks, so, against really good rushers, so, he actually has a lot of talent. I actually do like Nicholas Petitfrere, even if he's just a complete mess right now. Daniel Brunskill was pretty darn average last year. I mean, wasn't he a backup? Last year, I forgot. I think he started in 2021. I've not heard about him for a while, so let's see. Daniel Brunskill, yeah, he was a backup last year. 2021, he played a lot more snaps. He's actually decent, but last year, he wasn't so hot. Aaron Brewer's a bottom 20. Bottom 10 center. He's not awful, but he's not very good. Iron Miller's a bust tackle, but he was at least serviceable as a backup with the Eagles. And Peter Skronsky is going to have to be very good if his offensive line is going to be anything special. And not surprisingly, this offense actually comes out to a B. Will I give them that? Probably not, because, again, the offensive line, when you have, like, a guy I've never heard of as a backup, that's not great. But I will say this. The offense should still have a really good running game, but the receiving, I mean, the passing game should be a little more back to 2021. But will it be? I really don't know, because I haven't seen this offense yet. And again, with Tim Kelly being the offense coordinator, I expect it to be a little better. I'll line it right up with this tight end core. I'll give it a B-. I think this offense is decent, but talent-wise, it's relying a lot on Derrick Henry, obviously, and if Ryan Tannehill gets hurt, this offense is going to be crap. I mean, it's as simple as like that. Again, If they lose Ryan Tannehill and Darren Barron again, it's just going to be the same thing as last year. I'm just sorry. That's what it's going to be like. Those two guys have been the glue of this team ever since they went on a run in 2019. Let's get right into this defense, starting out this linebacker core. Actually pretty good. All right, for this offensive line, I really don't know what to give them because they've got the depth isn't good per se, but it's serviceable. So the depth I honestly will come back to later, but just regarding the starters, they really don't have a solid dude. I mean, I get Nicholas Petitfrere, yes, but he still wasn't very good last year. I mean, that's kind of what it was. Really flashy run blocker, but that's kind of about it. Which kind of how you could become a flashy running back there. I really don't know, but if you watch him on film, you can see. But really good again, maintain leverage. But back to it. Peter Skoronski at this point is probably the most reliable offensive lineman's team. He's never played it down yet. Yeah, he was 11th pick, but that's just not good right now. I mean, there's a reason he's playing guard. I'll just put it like that. So I'll probably give them a D. But their depth is decent, and I do like what they got. But it's just it's kind of a big hot mess right now. 4 points to the offensive line. Time to the overall offensive grade. So happy that the Titans run that 3-4 defense. I mean, their defense should be pretty good. First things first, though, looking at this linebacking core, it's not very impressive. Monty Rice was actually not too bad last year in coverage. That's actually why he got a couple starts towards the end of the year, but he didn't stay totally healthy. And he struggles mightily against tight ends. I don't know for what reason, but he just can't really the ball skills are just really not there by getting a linebacker. Did have 66 tackles, though. Should be fresh for this season. I expect him to be decent. Azeez Ashai is a turnover machine, though. He got hurt last year. Didn't look the same either. I mean, he had that huge year in 2021, but he ain't going to do much, again, in coverage at all, but he's just going to make a ton of big plays and really aggravate defense offenses because he's actually a pretty good run stuffer as well. Luke Kuechly, very backup-ish guy. I mean, played with the Cowboys a couple years. He was pretty serviceable. Really unathletic, but he is a good football player. Ben Neiman, he's decent. Again, with the Cardinals, he actually was, I'm not going to lie, he was probably their most reliable coverage guy. At least in zone, at least. I mean, even probably better than Buda Baker and Byron Murphy Jr. He's actually pretty good in zone, but he still can't seem to make a tackle behind the line of scrimmage. I don't know what it is, but he's kind of like a safe guy. He's a good backup. And then Chance Campbell, who's also decent as well. Again, Ole Miss didn't play a lot last year, but I do expect him a decent year. When he gets some, and even Jack Givens. I mean, they actually have some good depth in this lineman core. It's just not crazy. Depth is good, but I'll give him a C+. Yeah, Azeez Ashai should be good, but you didn't look great last year. And Rocky Rice is probably a starting caliber player, but that's probably about it. In the backups, again, they're good, but it's a decent lineman core. It comes out to 9, 18 points, time for the defensive line. Low-key, one of the best defensive lines in the league, except they are not the best run-stopping defensive line in the league by any means. So they, honestly, I don't know. They just don't get as much penetration as I'd like. But whatever. Jeffrey Simmons wasn't as good as he was in 2021, but he was still really good. I mean, he can get after quarterback, make a ton of stops against the run, a ton of pressure. One of the best interior rushers in the league. He's a freaking beast. Julio Johnson. Really athletic, but he still needs to work on getting some of those pass rush moves going. I mean, straight up anything would be better than what he tried last year. I mean, again, promising, but just not great yet. Tiertar is a definition of a wall. I mean, he even got it to quarterback. Low-key, one of the better nose tackles in the league. Very quality. Naquan Jones, 25. I'm not going to lie. Didn't get to see much of him last year, but in 2021 he looked good. So, maybe he'll be good again this year. Denico Autry, probably the most bona fide pass rushing interior dude in the league at this point. I mean, wasn't as good as he was in 2021. He got hurt. But Denico Autry, again, he's really good. This all these stars in this defense line are really good. Not, I mean, Jarvis Simmons is the highlighter, but they're all good. But yeah, Jaden Peavy is really the only guy that I have questions as a backup. But he's kind of, again, they have like 5 guys. They should be fine. I'll give them an A- because there's just not too much. Do I give them an A? I don't know. Do I give them an A? I'll give him an A because Tiertar is actually pretty good. So, the ends on this defensive line are freaking crazy. Like, the 3 techs, holy crap. You're not going to get a better duo in the league. Tiertar's a good quality nose tackle. The backups, little questionable, but you can't get better with those starters. So, I got to give them an A. Comes out to, 6, 12, 18, 24 points, right? 6, 12, 18. I'm slow. 22 points. Time for the pass rush. All right. I'll first say this. Harold Landry was one of the most consistent AFC passers, not NFC, because, you know what, he was one of the most consistent and number one passers back in 2020 at 12 sacks, ton of pressure, really good at bending off the edge. I mean, he was just awesome. Last year, tore his ACL. I don't expect them to be crazy, but he still should be pretty good. Arden Key, thank God they brought him back. He had 4.5 sacks, pretty good guy. Actually had some consistent pressure, but y'all have to take a step up here as that number two. Rashad Weaver, weird guy. I wouldn't call him a bum, but if he doesn't get to the quarterback, he kind of just gives up. So he definitely got to have definitely a more consistent motor. And also, I mean, just get a second move. Like, he has one swim move and it just doesn't work. Sam Akuga, but never heard of him, but he had a half sack last year. So, I mean, honestly, this could be a worse depth. I mean, yeah, Caleb Murphy is net. I mean, what the heck? But, yeah, they've got, like, four pass rushers. Tam, whatever, it, again, isn't great. But they have three decent guys. Like, I mean, they got two, number one, number two, for sure. But, Roger, the depth just, in this pass rush just isn't great. And the interior is awesome. But the depth is just not great right now. Which means I'll probably end up giving him a B+, because, or a B. Do I give him a B+? I mean, there's just no depth, because no gonna be, because if they had, like, two more guys with Arden Key, it would be golden. The interior is really good, but again, Harold Landry as the number one edge rusher, again, we haven't seen him in a year, I'll give him a break, but I gotta give him a B, because it's just, again, the interior is awesome, but there's no depth, and your number one is just, we don't know yet, so B. Comes out to 32 points. Time for the cornerbacks. Okay, first up, Sean Murphy Bunting. They brought him in to be a number one corner. There's really no way around it. Like, yeah, I only played 12 games last year, but he was pretty darn good. Honestly, his best year as a corner overall. So, I do expect him to be their number one. Christian Fulton, when he was on the field, wasn't the same guy. I mean, that's just what he was. He's supposed to be a man guy. Wasn't that at all. His ball skills kind of disappeared. Wasn't the same player. I mean, he's still decent, but he wasn't as good as he was. Roger McCreary, actually, yeah, he gets targeted a lot. He does struggle somewhat in man, but his zone play is really good. Pretty solid slot. I mean, he's not crazy great, but he's pretty good. Caleb Farley was god-awful last year, god-awful the year before. Caleb Farley sucks. Farley sucks. I mean, there's no way around it. He can't stay healthy. When he's on the field, he's terrible. Trey Avery is burnt toast. Steven Jones Jr. is pretty bad. Chris Jackson had that one pick six. That's all I really remember. They've got three corners, and that's it. So, keeping that in mind with the cornerback room, I'll honestly probably give them a B-. I mean, Roger Curry and Sean Murphy Jr. are great. Sean Murphy Bunting are great, but Christian Fulton just was dead average last year, which I think could be bet worse. But the rest of the group's just a bunch of bums, so I gotta give them a B-. I mean, definitely not the worst cornerback room in the league, but it could definitely be better. So, comes out to, 6, 12, 14 points. Time for the safeties. All right, with these safeties, first off, Kevin Byard is the best safety in the NFL. He is, yeah, he is. So, and here's why. He does make tackles. Is he going to go up and do what Buda Baker does and just absolutely stuff a run from 20 yards down back? No. But what he will do is just be simply the most consistent coverage safety in the league. There isn't a guy who can do what he does in coverage. It's as simple as that. Like, ball hawk underneath, anywhere, anytime, doesn't miss tackles. Kevin Byard, the best safety in the league. That's what I got. Also, backup Elijah Molden, rough rookie season, but actually towards the end when he was up. No, I'm not saying that was 2021. I get confused with him. 2021, rough rookie season, but he did show some promise, so I'm okay with that. But last year, he got hurt. Like, what, did he blow out his knee? Something like that. And he's got to show he's actually good this year because this is like his last year. Mike Brown, Matthew Jackson, kind of both bums, but I will say Mike Brown at least can make some plays in special teams. That's about it. We'll probably watch him in preseason. Amani Hooker, injury mess last year. Hope he can actually get some consistency this season and actually be able to play the whole season. I mean, he didn't, like, not like a terrible injury, just got like five different ones. He had like a shoulder, a knee. I thought he like had some stomach bug. I don't even know. He just had a rough year. That's kind of what it was like. On the field, though, he was pretty good. So for these safeties, I'm honestly going to give them an A. Do I give them an A-? I'll give them an A-. Kevin Byard is that good, and Amani Hooker is also really good. So, I mean, again, when he was on the field, Amani Hooker was good. Like, I'll just show you PFF, like, for reference. But on film, he looked good. In college, he wasn't too bad. So, yeah. Amani Hooker, he's good. But the depth is questionable. That's why I gotta get him the A-. If they had better depth, it would be an A+. And I do expect Elijah Molden definitely proved himself. Like, it's not like he's terrible. So, it comes out to 9-18-27, 30 points, time, the overall defensive grade. If there's defense, again, it really the reason they come out to about, like, a B- is literally because their pass rush... No, it's because their linebackers are kind of mid, and the pass rush isn't as good as I expected to be. So, keeping that all in mind, though... I'll probably give them a B. Honestly, a B. Because, I mean, this defense always outperforms its talent. Like... The really reason is because they have, like, their defense is actually pretty thin. Outside of the linebacker position, I don't think there's a part of this defense that's, like, deep at all. Like, the secondary is, like, six players. And that's being not, six players. They got six guys in the secondary, like, that are, like, truly reliable. Pass rush, very thin. They've got, like, two edge rushers at this point. Three edge rushers. Defensive line's pretty good, though. Again, there's depth, again. The linebacking core is pretty mid, but they got at least decent depth. Like, the secondary is paper thin, the edge rushers are paper thin. You just can't have that in the league at this point. I gotta give it, again, B. I wanna give my B+. They always outperform me. They're probably, like an A- level, probably. They are, again, the identity will come back here, but I gotta give them a B. Time for the special teams unit. Alright, Kale Shudak will be their kicker this year. He actually was pretty nasty last year when he played. How many games? Yeah, he had that one game. He actually was pretty nasty. He did miss that one kick, but I actually think Caleb Shudak will be a decent kicker. Ryan Stonehouse, brick punter, pretty good. Yeah, basically about it. Kyle Phillips should be a really explosive punt returner if he can stay healthy. Julius Chestnut, one of the worst returners in the league, just won't bring him back. Yeah, he's not great. And Morgan Cox, how long has he been a long snapper for? A really long time. Just very good at that. Fans always have issues with special teams, but this year it's a little more promising. I'm still giving him a C-. Like, Ryan Stonehouse is decent. Kyle Phillips is decent, but outside of that, it's just not great, so C-. Again, Morgan Cox is good long number two. They all have issues, though. So, that comes out to 3, 6, 7 points for that special teams unit. Time for the overall team depth. All right, looking at the Titans' depth. Quarterback depth, I'd probably give, like, a C-. It's just not reliable, but at least they got depth. Running back depth, C. No, C+. It's good. Wide receiver depth, C+. Honestly, could be worse. C+. It could be worse. Tight end depth, D+, probably. I mean, Trayvon Lisco at least can play. That's about it. Offensive line depth, I don't know what to give this. D+. C-. So, looking at the offensive depth, it's, like, not going to be crazy. I'll honestly probably give it, like, a C. It's just kind of around average at this point. Defensively, linebacker depth is probably, like, a C+. No, you're not going to be B-. Defensive line depth is probably about a C. Pass rush depth, as a whole, it's probably like a C-, so I'll give them that. That comes out for out probably the C so far. Quarterback depth is probably a D, which probably bumps it down to like a C. No, D+. Yeah, it's not very good. Safety depth is really questionable, probably D+ as well. So, keeping that all in mind, I'm going to probably say they have D+ depth on defense. So, brings their depth around to probably a C-. I'll give them a D+. Titans are a pretty thin team this year. They got some positions that have some promise, but that's kind of being nice. So, what is that? 12 points? They don't got good depth. Time for the overall identity. Okay, let's talk about the Titans' identity. First off, offensively, they're going to run the ball 1,000 times, and they're going to have a much better passing. Decisive passing game? It'll be better. Defensively, again, they always outperform simply because they learn how to stop the run, and they have very disciplined guys in coverage. And they somehow get the quarterback one way or another. I mean, the Titans, they've always got a good defense with Mike Vrabel. I expect them to be great. Mike Vrabel's defense isn't going to be, they can't turn absolute SHIT into chicken salad. But they can turn it into, if they have, you just can't do that. Like, he's never done that. But he's had good players and turned them into a really good defense. So, overall, I honestly got to give Titans identity an A. It's one of the best in the league. The reason it isn't an A+ is because, again, Ryan Tannehill and Derrick Henry get hurt. They're not going to win any games. It's kind of simple like that. I don't know what to say. Like, they're not going to win many games. I'll give them an A, but they're not going to win many games again. So that comes out to, what is that? Do I give them an A+? They have, like, one of the best cultures. I don't know. Do I literally give them an A+? No, I can't give them an A+ because last year they just completely fell apart. It comes out to 15, 30, 45, 55 points. Time for the overall roster grade. And this tight end draft here actually falls into a B plus actually, which ain't no way I'm giving them that. I'll give them a B-. First off, I mean, I get the identity is so good, but bone for bone, this roster is not better than, it's just not very talented, I'll be honest. But it's good. The Titans have a solid roster this year. It's just not that great. Like, there are holes on this team. The depth is terrible, so I gotta give about a B-. Again, they do have a pretty promising roster. They're gonna, again, the identity will come back for them for sure, and same thing with the points, but just straight up, they're just not that talented of a roster, in my opinion. Just eye test and overall. So, yeah, B-. Again, I can change this. I'll give them a B-. Again, the letter grade, it might not look pretty, but the points will when we get to the resumes at the end with the power rankings before predictions. So, keeping that in mind, I do think the Titans have at least somewhat of a good shot. So, B-, 313 total points, guys. Hope you guys enjoyed the Titans 2022 roster grades. See you in the next one. Should be a lot of fun. Yep.
Rams show blitz. They come with it. Garoppolo firing deep. He's got a man wide open. Sanders has it inside the 25. A bomb to Emmanuel Sanders, 46 yards, and two conversions on 3rd and 16. Are you kidding me? To watch the top. Jalen Ramsey 20. Taylor Rapp 24. Taylor Rapp is so.